people are in this tournament, by the way. So he's starting to look quite strong.
Give me one second as I'm just launching into the game. Hopefully you have a game like available to jump into. So there we go. Yep, we've got it.
Oh,
so
yes.
It is ready. Let me get you. You're going to have to Steam message me the password again because I've forgotten. Oh, no, I know it. Sorry. Obvious. But not obvious. Don't try it. It's not obvious what the password is. We would never do something like that. Okay, are we ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Okay, fantastic. All right, we're going to go over to the wait screen. We'll jump straight into the tournament from there. Ah, for goodness sake, really?
MNAR27, is GCS patch live in Automatch yet? Not quite. Not sure I can say when it's going to be live due to NDAs, and I'm always careful about Relic and such, but yeah, it's coming. You're Stormless. Stormless, I'm not with you, by the way.
No, that's fine. It dropped because the password wasn't correct, so...
Ah.
Yes, do you know what it is? Maybe we should contact one of the mods that set the game up. Just ask them what it is. Yes, K-Pan, I did. I thought it would be a good opportunity to do that.
Very odd.
You're just going to Steam me when you've got it?
Yeah, I've got... okay. That's... he wasn't meant to use a password. What?
Oh, really? Really?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
We know it's him, though. He just Steam messaged me.
Okay,
with
it works
regards
now.
To the start, the great thing about GCS is I have literally made a format that will be extremely easy to moderate. However, in the very first round, they're all going to be... It's going to be a little bit trickier with more players. So have you ever tried to cast a tournament from the very first round, Dan, where you're also organizing it?
No. I just prefer to stick to this unstable patch of ground that I sit on called streaming. It's which is also fraught with problems, but it's good fun. I enjoy it. Okay, we are actually ready to go straight away.
Straight away, did you just say?
Straight away, we can jump straight into it. Yeah.
With the greatest of ease, I'm so psyched, mate. Let's get on with it.
All right, here we go, guys. Game one of the Grand Championship Series is finally underway. I know we've all been waiting for this for so long. I certainly have. Devem versus Fahu is our first game. Predictions, eh?
Predictions. I can only promise you one thing. Blood, sweat, tears, toil, and in this case, warfare. Because we've got Devem, Fahu. One's incredible, one's insane. But they're both going to be bringing incredible pain upon each other. And there are actually little bits of rivalry going on at the moment in Automatch between the Insane Clan and Fahu, because he beat Aimstrong, then he gave Devem a really thorough beating with a series of Maxims and stuff in an Automatch. But this is the GCS patch, so no such thing. So I wonder what he's going to be doing with Soviets now.
Well, he's already gone for his Tier 1 structure. Sniper was actually in the build first, which he cancelled for the penals. I think he probably thought a little bit too risky, knowing that Devem would probably counter-snipe very effectively. But yeah, I'm surprised. All the time I've seen him recently, he has played Maxims. So I'm surprised to see him going with the Tier 1.
However, there is still Lendlease, and the Dushka is currently untouched. However, it is more costly than the Maxim, so it's more difficult to spam. So if you're a Maxim abuser, you will still have a machine gun that you can use. However, you can't use it as prolifically. So we'll see if he uses Lendlease.
I actually think Lendlease is a great all-round commander at the moment. As you say, like, the Dushka's crazy. The veterancy that the Dushka gets later on into the game makes it very, very powerful. Added to that with the call-in tanks, you know, you still get all the benefits of tanks that can cap, which I think is so beneficial to Soviets.
I must declare as well, the Maxim in the most recent GCS patch iteration, it's actually got a lot of suppression. It's like just slightly worse than MG42, but it has two more squad members. So, to be honest, really good machine gun now. It should still be used, possibly. So I'm looking forward to players actually using the actual Maxim now it's a decently balanced unit.
Will anyone use it if it's a decently balanced unit?
Possibly not.
That's the question here. Sniper's just come out on the field. Got a nice early engagement here. Devem really locked into the penal battalions early on, which means he got a lot of health damage. Now he's just picking off the models, and this could go either way. There we go. That's another model down. It's a great start.
Bahu's penals are doing a great work here. It's a two-man squad situation, and Devem conservatively retreats. He's not doing the usual Devem hyper-aggressiveness. He's got the Pioneers with the newly buffed MP40s to come in and tag team the penals and push Bahu's penals away.
He's done a good job. Devem's going to take double fuel early, which is great for getting that kind of light vehicle rush out at the start. It'd be very, very good against the tier 1 as well. So Fahu losing double fuel, this could be really, really bad for him. We're going to see sniper from each player, which always results in really nice, kind of gameplay on the map where we're going to be seeing them try to counter snipe. One of my favorite things to cast, eh?
Yes, indeed. The sniper battles, especially with the Wehrmacht Soviet sniper situation. Because I know there's one thing that you're waiting for, Stormless, and that's Veteran C1 on that Wehrmacht sniper.
It's my favorite thing, is that incendiary round. So beautiful. And it's actually the perfect counter, of course, to the Soviet Sniper 2 model team.
It is indeed, and it just requires skill to execute. I believe Lovenest is the most prolific user of that double tap ability. But I know very well that Devem is a good user as well, so maybe he'll be using it today.
I mean, if nobody knows what that is, by the way, Veteran C1 for the sniper basically unlocks the incendiary round, which can be quick-fired even after the sniper is shot. And the reason it's so effective against those two-man teams is because as soon as you take one of the snipers down, the other retreats, you can pop the incendiary round and basically wipe that sniper squad. So it's a really good... I mean, obviously you have to play the sniper well in the early game. Something that Devem will definitely be able to do. But I mean, at the moment, this is very passive.
Yeah, it's going to pass Devem in a tournament. It's going to be a little bit more passive. He's only just woken up, remember, literally. Dan, I've just spotted the funniest thing in my Steam messages. I just have to call it out on stream. I told Fahu to set the game up to speed things up a little bit. And I said, no password. But I accidentally put an H in front of the no. So I said, no password. Sorry, I'm just giving the password away. It is HNO. Well, we weren't meant to have a password anyway. Oh, okay. There you go.
That is actually really password. Funny. The language barrier is a little bit of a thing there, isn't it? It's quite funny.
No password. Sorry. I'm just cracking up over here. What a great game, though. He's tagging out with the Grenz now. It's got a good amount of kills, good amount of veterancy already. No upgrades so far for Devem. He has got 90 munitions, so I wonder what he's going to be using them for as Wehrmacht.
I have a funny feeling he'll go for something with G43. I mean, that to me seems sensible when you're dealing with snipers because you can fire on the move with you know.
No, I just remembered. He goes for the Flamer half track. He's waiting for 100.
Oh, did you just... The snipers go down straight away to a rifle nade from Devem.
What?
Bahu did not even flinch. Both sniper models die. A huge loss. Bahu's going to have to build another squad. And he just isn't pushing territory at all. I'm sensing a lot of fear from Fahu here.
Yeah, a lot of fear. It is Devem at the end of the day. He is a scary, scary, scary bastard.
And I'm going to do it.
Go on.
I'm going to talk about the game psychology.
What?
Because there is psychology in this kind of game that just wrecks players. It makes you, like, even the best players, you know, if you come up against someone against Devem, you're just going to feel like you're losing, and you won't make the same kind of performance you normally do. I'm totally getting that right now from Fahu. This is so uncharacteristic of what I've seen him play recently. And, you know, that, it's just psychology.
However, it is a best of five. And as a best of five, he'll have time to warm up, he'll have time to relinquish that fear and start playing with more balls. And stop doing strange things like losing snipers.
Second one is on the field now, trying to work its way through the MG team in the center. And quite happy to stay in the green cover there and just kind of keep the vision. Keep that vision on so the sniper can hit that MG team.
I think when the Flamer half track comes out, Dan, it's going to be so difficult for Fahu to counter. Now he's gone for a sniper in addition. It's going to be brutal.
Yeah, it's what is that 720 manpower spent on snipers in the first 7 minutes? It's just begging for the light vehicle rush, which is coming now. The scout car's coming up for Devem. Although Devem may lose the squad here if he's not careful. Oh, he does. Grenade is.
Oh,
go down.
Okay. Okay, so he's only 60 manpower down now because he's traded. Well, 80 manpower down rather. He's traded 320 squad for a 240. So, if Fahu's getting back into it.
Yeah, I think he'll appreciate that. Like, Devem's obviously looking to just triple cap and push the field. And, I mean, that's the kind of time, really, when players can make mistakes. A little bit of a strange one here. In fact, the Soviet sniper isn't even stealthed at all, leaving Devem with a nice opportunity to get a shot there. He'll be able to recloak quick enough as well to get the second shot!
Oh!
Yes, he does!
Yes!
Oh, that was so beautiful to watch. He timed the veteran team perfectly. As soon as Vet 1 popped, incendiary straight on that sniper. Huge mistake from Fahu, leaving it out in the open.
Let's quote the internet meme where they kill the crab with the scissors. He kills the Fahu. Because Fahu's... Yeah, we're not here to glorify the brutalization of Fahu. We're here to watch great Company Heroes 2 games. It's just, in my opinion, Fahu is struggling against the psychology of playing Devem. I haven't seen Devem do anything spectacular other than killing the snipers, but he's done that quite easily, and we all know Fahu's actually a fairly decent player. Yeah. So we're definitely looking to see Fahu to warm up and to get back into the series.
Yeah, I think that's a good point to mention as well, is that Devem hasn't really done anything, like, extravagant here. He's just played very safely. He's... you know, kind of just walk to the territory, taking down what he can as he goes. At the moment, it feels like just more mistakes are being made from Soviets.
Yeah, the Soviets losing two sniper teams. It's just not what you want to have happen at all. It's he's in a very difficult situation. And his army size is really showing it as well. 22 pop cap currently.
I mean, I guess I would be surprised at this point if we didn't see Lendlease picked, because he's obviously going to want a call-in rather than teching. I would be surprised if that comes from anti-infantry tactics. I mean, his options also in the IS-2. It's a long way to wait, though.
Yeah, to be honest, he's thinking strategically is not what he wanted, not what he can afford right now. He's got to think tactically. He's got to start winning engagements. He's got to go trading up somehow and getting back into this thing. And going up against a 2-2 with a combat engineer possibly might not be the best way to accomplish that.
No, he's trying to test the field at the moment. And it's quite threatening for Fahu because obviously the left side is actually pretty locked down. He doesn't have a tier 2 to bring out support weapons. None of his commanders pack a HM120, so he has to go up to that tier 2 if he's going to start clearing the support weapons. He also needs an AT gun, but he's going to try and rely on munitions income for the PTRSs on the penal battalions. And it's just a recipe for disaster. There's no counter-teching here, there's no fault identification. AT grenade goes on that scout car, PTRS is gonna try and finish it off with a long shot. Yes, gets
might
it.
Get it, and does indeed get it. And there you go, there's Fahu trading up yet again, or well, trying to get back in the game rather. He's lost his two snipers, so he's definitely still down. However, he has gotten a Gren back, and now the Zweisfanzig scout car has been destroyed. So Fahu is capable of getting back into this, and one mustn't count him out just because he's up against Devem and just because he has lost those snipers. Anything is possible in Company Heroes 2.
Yeah, that is very true, and especially with army sizes being the size that they are. I mean, the resource difference right now is obviously going to be a lot different. We've got a tier 3 going up for Devem in the base right now, which means we're going to be seeing medium tier vehicles on the field very shortly. I think, like, you know, we're actually coming up to the amount of fuel. Whether he decides to rush an Ostwind, I think he'll probably realize that, you know, Fahu, you know, he's going to have to either tech tier 2, and he's not going to be able to get a call in at this level, so Ostwind could be a good idea.
However, Devem has been literally going Panzer Fear in every single Wehrmacht game. Okay. But I would like to see a little bit of adaptability to the situation from that damn evil vicious mouths. It would be, of course, better as the SS mine, sorry, not the SS mine, Jesus Christ, the S mine rather, pushes away that penal squad.
The SS mine, yeah, it's a good one.
Yeah, oh dear. The S mine. So it would be nice to see some adaptability from Devem to go the Ostwind, because that's the best tool for this job of killing mass infantry.
I think it'd be a really good unit. Definitely the sensible choice here. What is triggering these mines?
Flailing dead Russians.
I was gonna say, yeah, because I don't really know what they're doing right now. Some kind of gravity
There was once a cast about 2 or 3 years ago where a flailing dead Russian body kind of triggered a mine and took out a retreating squad. I remember it was like the hero of the Soviet Union with his last dying effort, like just pushes his arm out to blow up a mine.
So I mean, people forget, like, those units that crawl around dead on the floor. I mean, I'm not actually sure I've clocked it that they still give vision, but they certainly used to give, vision on the map as they were dying still. You've got the option to kill them, you really should. But, I mean, the DevM, if he wants to, I mean, if he does decide to go with those G43s, could be using his interrogation to get a little bit of, map knowledge.
Yeah, I mean, DevM, lightning wall usage, it's pretty much... absolutely, synonymous with his name, to be honest, Lightning War. So G43 is definitely something I could foresee him going for. Well, of course, he only has the one Grenadier at the moment. However, of course, with the recent patch, Panzer Grenadiers would be a good usage for them. Had a few buffs. And he is, of course, getting the Panzer Fear, so he is definitely going for tried and tested DevM weaponry.
I think Fahu's possibly found a little bit of a gap here. We've got a lot of engagements going on. Flame Thrower Pioneers are trying to burn the MG house, out of the house in the center. Got conscripts capping the right-hand side, looking to get VPs and fuel. And he may catch this MG42 on the retreat. And if he does get to wipe that and pick it up with the conscripts, it'd be a very, very good little swing back into the game.
Especially as he has the Maxim heavy machine gun, so make sure you show that thing's line of vision, line of attack now, Dan. It's V, whatever you want to call it. What the hell would you call that?
The cone of fire.
Cone of fire, that's it. Bloody hell, I'm rusty. But yes, sir,
the
cone of fire is
a lot. The arc.
The arc, thank you. You're good today. You've warmed up into this cast a lot quicker than I have, that's for sure.
I'm sorry.
No, don't be sorry. It's a good thing. I need to start doing...
Oh, he missed the cap.
Oh,
come on. I mean, he was trying to get the decap on resources there, and he actually got it right down to the last slither of cap he possibly could before retreating, but hit the retreat button a little bit too early, just leaving DevM to still retain resources and clear up the map with this Panzer IV.
How dare you question Fahu? Maybe the Panzer IV was literally a second away from destroying that squad, Daniel. Maybe he made the exact right decision. Could have done.
It's possible.
It's possible, exactly. What is very possible right now is a Fahu comeback, and I don't say that lightly. I don't say that just to hype the game up. But if you look at the actual map, the actual units in the top left and top right of your screen, it isn't beyond the realm of possibility.
No, it isn't. I mean, he's slowed the VP drain down as well. He's actually gone armored. This is again a really weird.
Oh, did you check that bundle made?
I did.
Holy
I
crap.
Saw it. I mean, I think armored assault is a really weird choice. I mean, I guess he is actually coming up to the amount of fuel. Probably will get there in time to bring up the IS-2, but it's a huge gamble.
It is, and it's one of those units that's going to be eggs in one basket. The bastion of Fahu's army, pretty much the white knight in shining armor to save him, and if it goes wrong, it's gonna fail horrifically.
We do have the AT out on the field from Fahu, still pretty much stuck in tiers 1 and 2 at the moment. Pretty much guaranteed he's not going to go anywhere else. I mean, the IS-2 is quite beastly. I mean, he actually lost one of his squads of engineers there. So, you know, I mean, how long the IS-2 takes to repair. The double engineers is absolutely essential if you're going to go into a unit like that. One of them's already down. I just feel like the manpower is constantly being harassed by,
Yeah, just to give you some stats here, I mean, DevM 77 kills, Fahu 44. The amount of manpower attrition done by DevM is pretty large throughout the game. So it's a testament to Fahu's courage and, enthusiasm to play that he's still in this one, to be honest.
Well, I mean, these first games, as we say, like, they're always a really, really good chance to just feel out your opponent as well. Like, you don't want to be just throwing in the towel straight away because, this is your opportunity to practice against the micro-engagements with them. If you do come on this situation where you're on the back foot, this is a little bit of a taster about how it's going to potentially be in the next game. So far, he's not going to want to really quit out of this. He'll probably want to see how far he can get back into this game with the resources that he does have and see how DevM deals with it, more importantly.
Of course, there is the victory point situation as well. DevM came into this with a 100 victory point penalty on account of being 20 minutes late. aka sleeping through the start of when he should have started playing. And so Fahu just want to drain as many victory points as he possibly can do, just for the glimmer of hope that might be an eventual ace game.
I mean, I'm just very surprised here. The snipers really probably would... They were supposed to be the counter to the support weapon play from tier 1, right? But then again, he didn't back it up with a commander that maybe had the HM120, so you know, he left himself forced into the tier 2 production. Still doesn't have indirect fire out, which I think would be really useful if he's going to be pushing with conscripts, you know, for smoke to just try and constantly turn the positions of the MG guns. Instead, he's just trying to flank with infantry. DevM's gone for a huge loadout of infantry to try and negate this from happening. And nothing's really, really working.
To be honest, the main reason I would foresee a player such as Fahu to go snipers against DevM is because snipers are very much a binary unit. They're either alive or dead. And that gap between them being alive or dead can be, you know, a millisecond of micro, a very small fragment of game time, right? So with Fahu, he's thinking, this is a high-risk, high-reward strategy. I'll go for snipers, I'll try and inflict manpower damage, and I'll just absolutely blitz it. I'll go for it. And it didn't quite work out that way. At all, in that his snipers were obliterated, but you can see why he thought it might be a good idea. Second Panzer Fear out, so the Panzer Act on the field very shortly.
Still no commander choice either. I mean, I guess he doesn't need one. He's probably still waiting to see exactly what far he's gone, because he may be able to draw out a quick counter. I mean, of course, one of those counters will be the JU-87s from Lightning War when he sees the IS-2. If he can get some kind of snare on it, that'll be a very, very effective way of dealing with that unit quickly.
It will be, and of course, it does not attack infantry, Daniel. DevM found this out, how long ago? 2 months, was it? In a King of the Hill game, live?
That was hilarious.
It really was. It's like, he asked me in Steam after, do those things not attack infantry? I was like, no, not since 2015. Oh, God. Yes, so if we were just to take a look at Fahu's army, he's clearly got to wait for the IS-2 now. But it's manpower. In saving up for that manpower, not reinforcing infantry and not getting back on the field, just to get to 640, he's going to relinquish even more of the map, and to the point he's just in his own base.
Yeah. I have a feeling he may not even get to it in the triple cap at the moment. We've got just over a minute left of gameplay with a triple cap on, and I have a feeling he may not get the resources in that time.
Yeah, he definitely has the fuel. It's all about the manpower, and then getting to the manpower, he's going to have to literally not reinforce. There you go, his conscripts in base not reinforcing right now. So he's going to get an IS-2 that comes on the field at about 10 VPs left. And is it going to be able to wipe all of DevM's army in that point and allow him to cap 2 victory points down?
No.
Good.
Quite frankly, a stupid foot.
Well, you can't blame a man for trying.
No, I mean, be fair to him. DevM, he's the number one seed. Very, very strong player, has been since forever. You're going to go into these things with a little bit of caution. He probably hasn't played as aggressively as he would normally. That's certainly not paid off for him with going tier 1 Soviets. And hopefully now he'll just see. Because, I mean, we've seen DevM make some mistakes here. You know, it hasn't been a completely clear wipe by DevM. So, you know, hopefully Fahu picks up on that. And in the next game, he feels a little bit more confident to go and make some decent plays.
Yeah, I think so. Game 2 is a fresh start, and he's got his best of 5 series. There we go, surrendered. And at that point, DevM had 486 victory points.
Interesting. First game, gosh. that was an interesting one. But I mean, that's again, one of these clear-cut situations. If you don't play the game, like... you're kind of lower down in the rankings of this. That was just bad teching. Even with the commander choices, it was nothing to back up tier 1 if tier 1 goes wrong. You know, why go for the second sniper straight away? When you lose it, if you're going to lose it like that the first time, why would you build another one? No value came from the first one. It wasn't like it was particularly, you know, effective. So it was an interesting one. It just kind of one of those games that really goes to show how, like, the value of teching and predicting opponent's tech.
With GCS, are you going to be rolling straight into a wait screen? Are you gonna? How are you going to leave the game, if you don't mind me asking? We probably should have rehearsed this.
Oh, we're in the lobby now.
Oh, wow, it's seamless. This guy is a professional. Amazing. By the way, everybody, if you follow this link in chat, that is to the Battle Planet app made by Kvazar. It's currently showing Dev Emmers winning that previous game with 386 victory points left, because I've just deducted him 100 for being late to the tournament. But yes, that's the first game done. And we're now waiting for the faction picks for game two, and then these guys can get started. Mm-hmm. Very exciting.
Yep, and we're currently on that battle planner now, just waiting for factions to go in. Second map, obviously, is Faymonville Approach. I say obviously, even though AE had to explain it to me earlier. But
I mean, I can explain it for everybody else if you like.
I think you should. I think you should.
Okay, this is going to be hilariously boring, but I'll try. Okay, in the first game, we flip a coin, and the winner gets to choose either map or faction. If he were to choose a map, the other guy then obviously chooses a faction of the different side, Axis or Allies. And then in game two, they swap Axis and Allies and they choose factions again on the same map. So that's games one and two done. You then got games three and four to worry about. This is a best of five tournament because it's a lot of money on stake and we don't want a best of three situation where the players feel cheated. So in games three and four, it's very much similar to game one. However, the other guy has pick first, the guy that lost the coin toss. So he can choose either map or faction first. And then in the ace game decider, should we get to one in a 2-2 situation, it's in order of map preference. It's automatically selected that Faymonville is our most preferred map, Clodney Firma, Crossroads, and Crossing in the Woods. And if any of those maps haven't been played in that order, that's your deciding ace game map. And the guy with the most victory points in his winning games, he gets choice. Is anybody still awake? Any resident sleepers out there in chat?
There's bound to be a lot now. So are we just waiting for the next game to go straight in, I assume? I don't think they'll waste too much time, will they?
They shouldn't do. You wouldn't imagine so. They have technically 5 minutes between games, so they should be ready to rock and roll, in my opinion.
Sweet. All right, let's just do a little bit of just a little bit of stream stuff here. We've got to do, first of all, score for DevM.
Fantastic. I will give out a shout out to somebody that's donated to the GCS from the Hall of Donations. And I think it's a good time to start with the guy that donated £1,000. Everybody matters, but we will start with him because he's the top of the list. So Army Guy X. This guy is from America. He's a wealthy fellow. He used to play CSGO over 10 years ago, and he just wants to give back to competitive gaming. And he absolutely loves Company Heroes 2. So he wants to give back to the community. He's been playing Vico since 2006. It's not about fame or prizes. He just wants to watch other people play and enjoy the tournament. And also, he's a filthy capitalist, so he knows money works best to get the good games in. So thank you to Army Guy X. There you go.
That was cool, actually. I mean, Army Guy just put the biggest injection of hype into this tournament at the start with that donation. Which was absolutely awesome. I hope he's here as well. And if he is here, massive love to you, my friend. Are we ready to go?
Yeah, their game is live. So they're not using the battle planner. This is the very first game of the tournament. So things are still being ironed out. And we will get it to be a much better, well-oiled machine come the semifinals. In fact, a month and a half's time. But yes, so I will actually note down the scores.
I mean, we can put them in anyway, can't we? We can.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah,
I mean, we've got the guy that made the app as watching right now. So this is a situation we're not prepared for when the players ignore the fact that they've got to choose their factions in the battle planner. But at least they're playing the bloody game, Dan. So I'm going to allow it.
I don't think we should complain. We should let them get on with what they're doing. To be honest, the battle app is cool, but it's not essential at this point. Looks like we're straight into the game again, though. I will update scores very, very quickly. Now I know what side they're on.
They want to give it 30 seconds of because he accidentally put a password on in because I said no password, HNO password. So we've actually completely circumvented all stream delay, which is bad. But these guys are honorable players. We trust them. We don't believe there will be any cheating because of this. So it's absolutely fine. But it wouldn't be fine if it was like some clanmates that speak in a different language or something, you know.
Yeah, All right, are we ready to go?
Okay.
Game two for today. Devem's already got one in hand after playing against Fahu from the south side of Zoster in the last game. This time playing USF in the north of Faymonville Approach. And you see he's rocking his nice little personal commander profile there from the Warpaint Championship.
He is rocking it, and he's rocking the most powerful faction ever to be wielded by one player. It's not the United States Forces. It's Devem's USF. This guy literally obliterated the field famously in Operation Charlie Fox a year and a half ago as this faction, to the point where he was requested to write a guide so everybody could learn from him. His USF play in Coming Heroes 2 was absolutely inspirational. It's fearsome. It's something to be fearful of. And Fahu's the guy playing up against him. So what do you reckon, Dan?
I think Fahu's going to have a better time playing with OKW this game. It's interesting as well because, I mean, you know, one of Devem's great things about USF was his lieutenant play. I always recall like how good he was with the lieutenant tech, you know, M20, or whether it's playing as Oster with the A half track. Like, he's just phenomenal with that. And I think actually OKW is a better choice to play against Devem's USF.
I believe so. It's all about getting that fast loot set. And if you can counter the early light vehicles, such as the M20 or the Stuart, with Rocket and play and a Faust, you can beat Devem's USF, but you're going to have to out-micro him, and that's a very difficult task indeed. You've got rifles engaging in close quarter combat against Folk's Grenadiers. I think the rifles are winning out in this engagement, and they will take that fuel.
This is already a horrendously late retreat from Fire. What is he doing? He's nearly lost this Folk's Grenadier. It's got across negative cover. It's against a couple of the riflemen. They could get a last shot off, and it goes down.
Oh, Fartu, what are you doing, son?
2 minutes.
And now we've got Stern Pioneers getting, for want of a better word, I won't say what I was going to say, but they're a sandwich between two squads, and they got obliterated as well. And you'd never want to lose Stern Pioneer models, or in fact get them pushed off the map, is OKW in my opinion.
No, I mean, that's a huge blow straight at the start of the game. It's an expensive squad to reinforce. It's going to put him back a couple of minutes, and he wants to be rushing out for that first vehicle for the OKW to help defend against what is pretty much guaranteed to be a Lieutenant Tech now, and M20 yes. Rush from DevM. I can't see him going anything else, if I'm totally honest, but it might still happen.
Yeah, I mean, he's got options, to be honest, at this point. Now he's pushed the Stern Pioneers off. He's wiped an entire Folk's Grenadier. A five-man squad got wiped in an engagement against another five-man squad. It wasn't the most inspirational play, so any new players to Company of Heroes, look away. That wasn't what you want to be doing. You want to be retreating those units.
Definitely, yeah. The warning signs were going on for a fair amount of time there. I think he was possibly thinking that the Stern Pioneers may have been able to come across from the road and sort that engagement out, but yeah, it just didn't really pan out that way. Unfortunately, I'm actually a little bit concerned about the direction here as well, because obviously, you know, he took the Kubel to the left, he took the Stern Pioneers to the middle, Volksgrenadiers to the right, and against USF, you know, when they close in, that high rate of damage comes in and makes it really difficult in those close engagements. So direction wasn't there at the start of the game. It was a silly move.
I always equate playing against USF to wave assault, like tower defense almost. You're against USF riflemen, this is going to be hard. Three rifles, can you survive? Well, in Fahu's case this time, no. But it's usually then, can you survive against the M20 play? Or then, can you survive against the Stuart play? And finally, can you survive against the Sherman? But it seems like Fahu nearly stumbled on the very first hurdle.
Do you know what I want to say? Oh, here we go, Lieutenant M20 straight away. It could have been faster selected. we all knew that.
4 minutes.
We all knew that was coming. I just think, like, the good thing about OKW for Fahu here is that it's very forgiving on bad teching, or if you do lose a squad in the start of the game, because, you know, you get AT. You get AT to deal with stuff at the start. You know, you've got units that can pop mines, and you just got your basic infantry. So he should have everything at least at the moment to deal with, unless he came up against a mortar.
Yeah, I mean, you say that, but we all know how aggressive DevM is. So if you haven't got a full army against DevM, he is going to, for want of a better word, brutalize you. So we'll see. But now we've got a rifleman, one more squad. This could be Fahu's revenge. Will he be able to get it? Difficult retreat path. Kubel's not facing the right way. Two-man first grenadier trying to focus him down. Looks like he's going to get away. So there you go. That could be the, like, something that Fahu needs to get back into. Something like that.
He made the best of a bad situation there, because the Kubel was in trouble. He was going to get 1880. He may as well focus fire the squad. But M20 now is going to try and chase in, and that's forced Fahu to retreat as Volksgrenadiers from the right. In fact, all units currently in a retreat state at this point in time. And there, I wonder if Devim's actually clocked that the Kubel is still on that right VP, because that could be a very nice little pickup there, and I think he is going for it now.
I'm surprised the M20 is not being more aggressive than it is. I think he fears the Rakettenwerfer that is only just about coming on the field, so probably wise to do that. And that is the beauty of the psychological. Oh, he's found the Kubel!
Gosh.
Kubel was hiding, Dan.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure he would have been able to see that. He definitely spotted it going off, so.
Find a general. Ooh, getting very close to the shoe mine.
Yeah, this has been interesting. I mean, like, you know, the M20, of course, the USF don't have that ability to just jump out of the vehicle and crit repair instantly as they used to. So mines like that can actually be a lot more devastating
than
they ever have been.
Devim seems to be not losing his M20. The rifleman take a bullet for the M20. And Fahu's got to be safe. Where is his luck in this game?
I don't know. I mean, there's a good mine placement, really. It's a huge shame that didn't actually come off the way that he wanted to, but Devem's micro with this M20 is pretty solid. Fahu's continually retreating rather than fausting.
Well, he can't faust, Daniel.
Yes,
you can.
You just need
the
tech thing.
No,
did you remove that? Did you remove it?
Yes.
You removed it, didn't you?
Yes, of course I did.
So there's me.
Terrible.
There's me after last time thinking, how could they faust? What is this? So now I've learned. Now I've learned that you only need the OKW structure out to be faust, and now you've changed it back again. Well, thank you.
I'm gonna sit down. Some people like to read the patch notes.
They're changing so often. I mean, we're not having a talk.
It's not my fault. You like to learn by watching, and that's fine. That's beautiful. It's natural. But you will be a little bit delayed at times if you do that. That's all. Well, that's all it is.
Thank you.
You're mad at me, aren't you? Oh, no. It was a good change.
My Everybody's therapist tells it. Me it's a good way of working.
Oh, God. Frontier psychiatry. A capture point is under attack.
Well, I mean, yes, Devim is just closing this game. I mean, just to get back, I know that there's not too much to talk about at the moment because Fahu's just fighting out with infantry. He's trying to come up against this M20. He hasn't been able to deliver Faust, the Raketen. It just isn't finding any of the lines. And again, yeah, he's spreading out. And I don't understand this decision to spread your units out across the map, because it's one thing to maybe just fill out where your opponent is, but he just doesn't have the power of OKW grouped together to actually be able to deal with threats. So he's just being torn apart by quick allied play, which is exactly what Devim excels at, even in the best of situations. It's a catastrophe of a game for Fahu at this point.
The M20 has done very well for itself. It's got 7 infantry kills, 1 vehicle kill. It's done very well there. Well, it doesn't even need the M20. I know he is using it to a great effect, but he could probably do this without just the infantry and the lieutenant, to be honest.
Is he going for base?
He's going for base!
I hope he finds the battle group a little bit. Okay, I think he's just backed out there.
If anybody's wondering why, so everybody needs to know this, of course. The Faust did get changed, that only when the truck was on the field. Hang on. Might have the Faust. Yes, the Faust is now available. Will he go for it? No, he'll retreat. That would have exemplified the point very well. But why did he get reverted? Well, because if you remember, in Winter Balance Patch, they were going to buff all light vehicles. And then Big Daddy Relic came in with his strap and started whipping the balance mod team, saying, "No scope! Scope!" So they had to literally stop all of their light vehicle changes that were going to be buffs. But they still kept in the Faust change, and then they realized late, in time for GCS, fortunately. So that's the story there, if you were wondering why it changed and then changed back to how it was.
It was a really odd... It was a really odd change, just because it negated so much light vehicle play that the allies could bring out.
Well, it made Kubel spam possible.
Yeah, and it's one of those things that, yeah, just doesn't need to be there, really. So, I mean, Ostia still get their foul straight away with the infantry, which is...
Oh, the Sternfein is difficult territory. Negative cover coming in. M20 might even be able to... No, I was getting excited for no reason.
DefM is just clearing up with this M20. It's all over the field. It's just a duck hunt.
It's like a mini game.
It is. It's mini games within Company of Heroes.
It's like clearing Fahu up. Oh, Fahu spilled out of his base again. Best clear him up. Let's clear him up again.
He's even managed to plant M6 anti-tank mines on the road. I mean, that takes a long time to lay.
I think DevM might have done us a favour by sleeping over his schedule for 20 minutes, because... No, I won't say what it's... That's a bit insulting to Fahu. He's a very good player, Fahu. By the way, Fahu, everybody is coming into this series rusty. Oh my god, folks, Grenadier about to die. Rocket and Verth managed to get the shot in. The folks could jump out of the garrison, however, smoke pops from the M20, keeps it ring-fausted, all the while the folks Grenadiers did indeed die.
Wasn't quite the trade I think he was looking for there, and it's a good idea to use the smoke to get away from that after the first Raketten hit. But let's just check out, DevM is now teched up with bars. He's now actually using bars on the echelons, and I gotta say, I absolutely love it when people put bars on echelons, because it makes the suppression, the volley fire ability, so good. You can just suppress those squads really, really quickly.
Oh yes, Vetsu Rifleman, difficulty getting out of there just in time. Now the ball suppressing the Pioneers, having to get out of there. As I was saying about Fahu, he is coming into this game a little bit rusty. He's warmed up for GCS, he's tried his hardest, he's gone from half incredible to now incredible, but not quite incredible enough.
No, it's funny because he changed his name, didn't he, before, to the not-so-incredible Fahu.
And then to the half-incredible.
It's kind of like an omen.
Yes, I thought it was like he's taking off the gloves. He's now full incredible. But, DevM...
I mean, in fairness, like, Fahu is one of the most surprising... I don't want to say, like, surprising in any way that's offensive, but, I mean, he's... When I checked out his player card recently, I was like, wow, really? I remember, you know, not that long ago, him being, you know, relatively... You know, the same ranks as me, but he's just jumped hugely.
Panzerfaust hunting, Dan. They sense blood with the M20. The smoke's already been popped. He can't get out of there again. He's got the munitions. He's getting within range. This could be one dead M20 very shortly.
Surely he can pop it now. Surely.
No, still on cooldown. Got another 10 seconds. He's trying to get behind this. Oh, there you go. He died dead and as a dodo.
All right, well, let's... Volksgrenadiers. Two Rakettens out, which is a sensible idea, probably knowing that Devem's going to be able to go for his late game tech, and that is the Sherman. Sherman's going to be on the field, got the high explosive rounds. Sorry, yeah, it is the high explosive rounds on. And this is a really, really nice spot for Devem to just clear up those Volksgrenadiers. As soon as these come off the field, Rakettens are not going to be safe at all.
This is like Devem as a caretaker, and he's been clearing up the Fahu spilling out of his base. Okay, the Volksgrenadier's about to die. He's been clearing out of his base with a rusty old mop that's not very good. Now he's bought, like, the Mop Buster 5000, the Sherman tank, and he's going to be able to mop everything up a lot more easily.
I really want that as a decal now, just to put on the side of the Mop Buster 5000.
Oh, God. We'll be having a decal, by the way, for everybody that donates to the GCS Kickstarter, still open for another 7 days. £20 donations will get a decal. I'm very pleased to announce also a faceplate that we will be getting made. Thank you, Papa Relic.
Oh, that's nice of them.
Yeah, they're nice guys. They have been very supportive of GCS. Initially, it's all been community. It's all about the community. The community have made this happen. But people have come on board, you know. It's been good. We've got possibly a massive, cool venue to announce very shortly. For the live final, we've got the studio. Even though they've got Dawn of War 3 coming out, they're still supporting us. So I think it's cool. Everybody's helping. It's awesome.
Oh, Fahu. Gotta make some kind of push out here. See, he can't really extend on the right side anymore. He doesn't have anything that's going to be able to clear those garrisons. He can't even get close to the MG to put the incendiary grenades in. So he's got huge issues at this point, and he's probably going to have to look at going for indirect fire. In fact, this
Pop out, trying to push away the high priority target that is the rear echelons with a ball.
I don't know how I feel about that. I mean, I probably at this stage would have preferred to have seen the LEIG, you know, just get some kind of indirect fire, just keep picking away at the either the health of the enemy squads, or at least, you know, at the buildings, just to, you know, keep the buildings unoccupied.
Look at this beautiful usage of green cover. He's currently keeping Fahu's entire army at bay. As soon as he sees the STG, Sturmgewehrs getting close, then he retreats. That is DevM in a nutshell. And people always go on about his micro, oh, he's so young, he's got fierce micro. No, in my opinion, he plays this game as it should be played. It's about gun battles, it's about making everything on your terms. And if it's not on his terms, he GTFOs. But in every engagement, he tries to make it on his terms. So watch him play if you want to get better. I can't see Romeo in chat. We do have Romeo confirmed for later today. He's going to be casting two matches today of other GCS action. Jesus Christ, what a long-range snipe from the Rakettenwerfer.
Yeah, that was good, actually. He finally managed to get those Rakettens working for him, but he does lose a Volksgrenadier squad that was carrying a bazooka as penalty for that. DevM clearly not going to let him get away with that for absolutely nothing. But this is still, you know, even taking that Sherman down, what are we looking at here? We've got double fuel for DevM, tons of resources floating in. Fahu's trying to go for deep VP caps at the moment, which is just going to get shredded by the mobility of the Shermans. So, yeah, you know, a little bit unfortunate with the Sherman, but it's absolutely no skin off of DevM's back.
So you're Fahu, right? You've not got many territory sectors. You're not doing very well. You're already 1-0 down. You've just, by some glory, by some meager possibility, managed to destroy the Sherman with a Rakettenwerfer at max range. What happens, Dan? The second Sherman rolls in and destroys your Volksgrenadier with its very first shot. Squad wipes. It's not going too well for Fahu, to put it politely.
I guess the thing is, though, is he's had to take these risks. You know, he's trying to overplay what he has to try and get, like, the Faust and then the two Rakettens working. You know, it is a gamble, and he's lost that gamble at least twice this game.
Yeah, it's been a game of gambles, and he's lost. He's at the table, you know. But he's still got possibilities. This is a best of five series. If it was a best of three, he'd be down and out. However, every player in this tournament has a fair chance to compete. They've earned their place in this tournament through placement matches or through having absolutely crap loads of tournament history in the past 2 years. So everybody's at the table. They've been seeded as fairly as possible, and everybody has a fair chance. So even the seed 32 Fahu against seed number one DevM is given absolutely every chance to get back, and he will be given that. This will go to a game three.
I'd be interested to see what the familiarity in factions is with game three, because I mean, DevM could kind of throw in the curveball and maybe play something else that hasn't been seen yet, but either that or Fahu hopefully has been, you know, memorizing some of the builds or some of the playstyles of DevM in US and Austere. Maybe it'll change the way he would play Soviets in a game three.
I think Fahu has not been playing to the zenith of his capabilities. Mine goes in, pushes the units away. So there, not mine, obviously grenade goes in, and pushes the units away, and Fahu has surrendered. However, he can wipe the slate clean now, Dan, and possibly make it happen in game three.
I kind of hope he does, to be honest, because, you know, I'm not just saying it, like, you know, he isn't a bad player at all. Something is clearly wrong with his game today. Not with his game, it's always wrong every day, but I mean, like, his actual game. yeah, but there we go. Second game, another clean wipe by DevM. 2-0 up in the series. Let me just change that little text here for you guys.
Holy crap, I'm loving your overlays. And I like how it goes yellow for the DevM versus Fahu.
I'm highlighting the ones, yeah, that we're on. And then, so people know what matchup we're on.
Aww, isn't that amazing?
I thought it was a nice touch.
So if you want to support everything that's happening today, it's going to be happening for the next. You've got until July the 1st to enjoy GCS. It's going to be one of those tournaments that, like the never-ending tournament, but it's only a 32-man tournament. But if you want to support us There are several ways to do this. We've got a Kickstarter that's still live. We need budget to make the live event as good as possible, to get players flown in and to keep producing assets for the tournament, such as the battle planner that we've already made, and also to reward you guys in the stream. Every penny you put in goes back into the tournament. Holy crap, we've had some more backers, Dan. Jesus Christ, we're nearly at 6K. Oh, really? Yeah, we've had £219 from Sherlock. You, my dear friend, are an absolute legend. £219 freaking pounds. That's massive.
I think he said something in chat about doing that, actually. And of course, I just said to him, I will be updating the top donators list in the description of the channel. So let's just have a quick look at the Grand Championship Series Kickstarter. 5,820.
Jesus.
Is incredible. Absolutely. And check this out. If you guys haven't seen this yet, !GCS in chat. You get to see a little bit of what's happening with this event. Of course, you've also got the spreadsheets that have all of the seeding and the players. There's just so much to look at. You know, I'd be surprised if everybody here hasn't gone and checked this out so far, because there really is just so much.
Also, you've got like CypherNex's stats as well on Code2.org. Everything about this tournament, if you're even slightly interested in competitive gaming and you like Company of Heroes, if you aren't turned on by this, you're doing something wrong. This is like nirvana for competitive gaming, especially for a small community like ours. This is really cool stuff, and it's really, if you're donating money, you may see on the Kickstarter, our original goal was 1,400. That was for a small tournament from Dan and I's bedrooms. That was on a low scale. All the money was going to be in the prize pool. We're now at a different kind of thing. We're now looking at esports venue, where you're all invited to come and watch live in person. If you can't make it, you'll be watching with thousands of other people live on Twitch. It's going to be off the hook. So every single penny goes into it. And tomorrow, for example, we've got a show match. We've got Nagano versus Joe for £100, because those guys, unfortunately, through no fault of their own, could not make the tournament. So just little things like that. It's going to be the gift that keeps on giving. You have my word on that.
All right, I'm just having a look if we've got that game 3 ready. I bet they're going to be going straight into it. Yes, they are. It's already there. Not wasting any time. This is an interesting one. I think we'll leave the kind of surprise here, but this is definitely a DevM map with a DevM faction. So not the most fortunate of picks.
That is the beauty of this selection process. So if you wanted to, you can just choose your so you get to, Fahu had a choice first, right? So he chose Faymanville, so that's games 1 and 2 done. Mm-hmm. Then Devem, it's his turn to choose. He doesn't have to choose a faction that was the opposite of what he just had, so he just went as USF, right? It's now his choice in game 3. He can either go map or faction, but he's not limited to Axis or allies, and he's gone for USF because, it's quite honest, it looks like he just wants to literally go 3-0 and smash Fahu. He's a very competitive guy.
There's a lot of surprises here. I'm just going to change the scores very, very quickly before we jump into this. But I mean, there's a lot to talk about with what the decision is from Fahu here, and I'll show you guys what that is.
Oh, you were talking about that a little bit more, I see.
Yeah, I mean, I obviously both of those points count.
But I can explain why Fahu's chosen what he has. I know why. If you want me to.
Well, yeah, I mean, let's have a little discussion about it as we go into game 3. This time the map is Crossing in the Woods. Devon's going to be playing his USF faction again. Fahu playing as the Austere. Just to talk about this choice, because his Axis, he's played OKW versus Devon's USF. I would have thought, if that clearly means he's probably more comfortable with OKW, he's now seen what DevM's doing, why wouldn't you play OKW again and try play it better?
Okay, so in game 3, DevM had choice, right? He had choice, and he chose to choose faction instead of map, which then gives Fahu double choice. He chooses a faction of the opposite allied axis, but he also chooses map. And there is no better combination in the possibly in the GCS combinations than Crossing in the Woods and Wehrmacht. It's such a good symbiosis. It's got large, wide-open territories that go into bottlenecks, which is perfect for MG42, snipers, PAK-40s. Anything that Fahu wants to utilize as Wehrmacht here, he can utilize very well. So that's why he's gone for it, because OKW don't necessarily have a map that's suited to them, but Wehrmacht certainly do.
I definitely agree with that, and I totally agree with his choice by far, who here to go Grenadier Sniper. A great early build there. Going to be absolute havoc for USF to try and deal with that, maybe even forcing DevM to go for Mortar this time instead of the extra Rifleman squad. I think one of those things, though, for USF here, is the smoke. Like, you know, all the infantry having the ability to get smoke, throw grenades, can be very, very effective against support weapon play and through those bottlenecks. As soon as they get through, like, you know, this, you're dealing with the high damage from close range units. This will be an interesting game. You're right, though. It's probably the best strategic decision that Fahu could have made.
Absolutely. It's the best thing he can do. Also, it makes DevM think. It gives him a clean slate. Fresh map. He can just see this as a best of three now. Unfortunately, he has to win every game in that best of three in order to win the match. But if he just thinks of this as a new start, a different faction, he's not played this one quite yet. He's got a sniper with its first maiden kill already, showing DevM his intent. And we'll be very keen to see how far he does.
This worries me, if I'm honest. I think, just having a look at this, it's like his wall, wired off the VP center like straight away, which is this fair enough. But the decision to go right on this map is one that I don't always agree with as austere, because, you know, it's wide open. There's a lot of flanking routes. Fuel is across the river, which gives negative cover. So if you had to defend that, you know, you're likely to lose squads on the retreat, or more likely at least. You don't have as much power to prevent units coming over the negative cover. You know, they're going to be fighting on normal ground. So you don't have those added advantages to take fuel, whereas fuel on the left side, and it's just been an easy pick for DevM. Now he's going to be able to try and deal with the right-hand side with all those things to his advantage. And I kind of feel like maybe it's to do with the cutoff down the center of the map. Maybe he doesn't want DevM to be abusing the cutoff next to his base and denying fuel, which is normally what he does. I'm just worried about it.
Bad to report for Fahu. He floated nearly 400 manpower in a competitive 1v1 against DevM. So it doesn't quite seem like his fear and his like rabbit in the headlights kind of effect is wearing off quite yet. So he'll definitely need to play very well in terms of micro and keep everything alive in order to keep settling into the series, in my mind.
I just don't know if he's really displaying it today. And again, we just see a classic example of where he's going wrong. You know, it's he was on the right-hand side of the map. He had decent map control. It was relatively, you know, close. He could have just kept pumping units onto that side and dealing with the problems. And he's just walked over to the left-hand side, losing all his territory on the right.
Look at this from DevM with that rifleman, man. He's literally, did you see how he went around that house? He hid like saboteurs, like partisans in the night. And now he's going to flank the sniper. This is so good from DevM. The sniper's not going to know what's hitting. It's out of cover. He's got it. It's Panzer down, however, the MG42 is covering. But still, that was exciting stuff.
That was a top level play. That's why DevM is seeded as highly as he is in this tournament. Absolutely beautiful using the line of sight feature to get around there. But I'm going to say, equally good of Fahu to actually have the MG set up in a position that was defending that. So I will give Fahu that. It was very well defended. It was very well predicted.
Yeah, if he did predict it, or he was just lucky. Either way, the sniper is still alive. He's going to have to now get the bunker and the healing up. He has done that, so the sniper's going to be straight back on the field. His economy's looking a little bit tighter. However, DevM's looking even more tighter. He's got the M20 out and upgraded in less than 5 minutes.
Rear echelons of the Minesweeper upgrade trying to take away the wire in the middle so they can cap that VP, and it's going to be a classic DevM triple cap, which every single game so far today it has been.
It's been crazy. Yes, it's been absolutely off the chain. I mean, we gave him a 100 VP penalty for being late. 20 minutes late, he did oversleep. Doesn't seem to have mattered too much, does it?
No. I just don't see what Fahu's doing here. I mean, once again, we're now on the right side of the map. You know, he's gone on the left, made a little bit of an effort on the left, decided he didn't want to go there, go to the right. I mean, you can't keep bouncing left to right with factions like this, because you're just going to lose all your territory and not win either. It's much easier for DevM to respond. He's a far more mobile army than support weapons, and a couple of grenadiers with a very fragile sniper.
fragile sniper that only has 3 kills as well. It's like, if you want to use a sniper, you want it to be good by 6 minutes. If it was out the second unit out, which it was, it's getting gunned down by the M20 as well. He's going to go deep, balls deep on this one.
Yeah, that's got to be a dead sniper, surely. Oh, it may get away. It's going to take a Faust for it anyway, so you may as well push in for the kill. There we go. Sniper goes down. Devon's going to try and get out. Probably one sniper left in terms of munitions resources. He'll get another one.
Give him another Faust, and it will be a Rheum armor hit. However, it's already got a damaged energy. He's just waiting for the other one to cool down. He's just got the Faust popped up. He's now waiting for the munitions. He's got the munitions. M20 is clearly going to die.
I would certainly hope so. We've got the riflemen pushing in. They've smoked the MG on that building, and Fahu's trying to focus on the M20, but the riflemen are going to push in. They've got a grenade in. Another grenade would probably take that house down, killing the MG inside. Fahu has finally reacted, though, and we'll be getting the MG out back to base.
Also gave him the bazooka from the M20, so that's not too bad.
This is an interesting engagement to watch there. Oh, no, it's not, because Fahu retreated. But I was going to point out the kind of recent differences to the Pioneers. Like, Oster Pioneers are incredible now. You know, you can get those close-range engagements with riflemen. You can win some of those engagements now. So it's a really nice change.
They're really well-balanced, I feel. It's like one of those changes that was just well done. They didn't make them overpowered. They just made them useful again in close-quarter combat. That was perfect. So GG, Winter Balance Mod Team. Who are now the GCS Balance Mod Team. And hopefully many more to come.
Hashtag stolen.
Did you say hashtag stolen?
Yes.
Oh, yes, we did steal them. We did indeed. And thank you, Relic, for making it happen. I mean, what better way to support the tournament than patch the bloody game to get rid of some of the worst 1v1 meta?
Yeah, I've got to say, respect them for that, 100%. The best support they could have given, to be honest.
We did kind of twist their arm a little bit. Well, in fact, I want to shout out to the community. You twisted their arm because that Kickstarter turned some heads. If it wasn't for that Kickstarter being so wildly successful, this game wouldn't be being patched with the patches it's being patched with, the 1v1 meta. It wouldn't be done at all. So well done to you guys as well. You've did very well there.
Hopefully it looks like Fahu has finally decided on the side of the map he wants to be playing. I really want to see him take the left here as a good opportunity where he could set up his support weapons, hold off the USF for a little while, and he's not too down on VPs to be able to do this. He's actually built a fuel cache in his base as well, clearly feeling the burn of not having that resource early on in the game.
I'm going to have to turn off chat. I am a professional caster. I cast professionally. The riflemen have done an amazing flank. They come south, pushing away the MG. The Grenadier and the Pioneer could have blocked them, but they're going to have to retreat regardless. And this is going to mean everything Fahu has goes back to his base.
I just don't agree with this at all. You've obviously watched a lot of DevM play. You know, DevM doesn't retreat unless that squad has really spent its time on the field. You know, he makes those squads work.
Yes.
They get to the bare minimum you could retreat them with, and that is when he's prepared to hit that button. Fahu's squad team, he's got like full health squads, there's loads of them, loads of the models left. So these early retreats, and DevM's just capitalizing on the time that Fahu is off the field right now. It's huge amounts of time. You know, time, as we always say, is a resource in this game. It's a huge resource, and DevM has so much more of that.
It's such to be honest. Oh my God, the 500 signs fan sig is going down. There you go. And to be honest, I'm not even gonna lie, I'm hyping that. It's just yet another thing to die. But it's just some of one of those things that is a hallmark of a great tournament level Company of Heroes player, is they're not reckless with their units staying in engagements. But they are ballsy, and they do stay in those engagements when they think they've got something to gain from it. So if DevM can stall you for another second, or if he can inflict more manpower attrition on you, grenade goes in against the Panzer Grenadiers, conflict more on you, he will do it.
That couldn't have sounded more lifeless.
What couldn't, sorry?
Panzer Grenadiers.
Sorry, it's just I get excited for those moments. I've done too much casting now for 2 years, so if something happens, I get excited. Then I remember it's just the round one, and it looks like a 3-0 whitewash. So it kind of mitigates everything I do.
That makes any sense. Fahu's trying to get VPs here. He's just trying to stall VPs whilst he reads the Code 2 manual.
And, God, that's brutal.
I'm joking.
That's what I was going to say, by the way. I was cracking up because I accidentally had chat up on my second screen. I saw some brutal things people have been saying. To poor Farhu, who's done nothing worse than try and play against Devem, probably the greatest on paper Company Heroes player of all time. And you've got to give him some respect.
I do, and this is the thing, like I've been saying this constantly, he is a good player, it's just a very big shame that that hasn't been shown today. And I mean, you don't really like get all these opportunities that often, do you know what I mean? Because like, as I said, like, you know, I know Farhu well, I check on him from time to time, and you know, I was really surprised to see how high his ranks were, you know, coming up into the lead into this tournament. And you know, people don't see that every day, you know, you don't get to see, you know, how good people are, and this is that opportunity, and it's sad that it's gone this way for him. He actually wiped some riflemen. A.
Oh, sorry, I've changed my push to speak button. My bad. It was giving me cramp.
Oh. What is happening? What is happening in this game? Like, everything's just started dying. Like, Devem's... Oh my god! Somebody stop the massacre! Think of the children!
He's already dead! Leave him alone! Poor Farhu! Oh, it's like that Ralph Wiggum crowd. When Krusty the Clown's getting beaten by Homer. He says, stop it! Stop it! He's already dead!
That was absolutely brutal. I don't know, like, is Farhu... There we go, he's going to hit the surrender. I mean, yeah, that was unfortunate. Really.
It was.
Devem is the number one seed here. So, you know, no real... You know, it shouldn't be a huge surprise that he won in the opening brackets. But the measure that he won by was very impressive.
It really was.
Couple of mistakes, though, I have to say. I don't know if it's because he just woke up, but I spotted a few things.
Go on, tell us what you saw, O Stormless Game Master.
I saw him losing squads. I saw some indents in preservation. I mean, I mainly just saw Farhu squads. But I mean, his teching is on point. I just think actually the only thing from Devem that looked weak there was a couple of preservation moments. You know, times when he probably should have retreated, lost the squad. Like, you know, losing squads to the Panzer Grenadiers, probably should have moved them away before they even got that close. You know, but the good thing about Devem, and we see this all the time, is that in tournaments, he's one of those players, he's a bit like a Von Ivan. You know, Devem can lose a unit and it really makes no difference to him whatsoever. That unit will just be built again instantly. He doesn't care about the time it takes for that unit to come on the field. He just wants his perfect build. He just wants that everything that's in his build order on the field and then goes for it. And I love that.
Yeah, also with Devem, you've got to consider that he's capable of such high level of play that he also has levels he can play underneath his top level. So if he feels he's already pretty much closed out the game and all he has to do is go through the motions of teching to the Sherman, maybe his attentiveness to towards units might not be quite so fervent. So everybody watching the brackets right now, it's been updated in real time. That's the glory of using Google spreadsheets as your brackets.
Yep, first series done. Hey, woo! I feel like we've reached our own milestone in this tournament. We've got so far before we get to this nice little J-box in the middle here. Who do you think it's going to be? Who do you think these four boxes are going to have as players in? So many huge names up and down the sides of the spreadsheet and a pretty long way to go. I mean, you guys can see all the dates here for tournaments as well. Make sure that you're on stream for these days because the games are just going to get better and better. Until we reach this huge climactic point that we just can't really speak about properly yet.
No, not quite. Our hands are tied. But what we're allowed to say is, I think they've allowed us to mention that it may or may not be located in Leicester, England. That's the biggest possibility right now. It is a studio that's capable of being a live venue that hosts attendees. And that's all we're allowed to say until we sign on the dotted line. But it's going to be absolutely epic. And they love the community feel of it. The fact that it's all an organic Kickstarter-funded tournament.